We will start straight away with a little presentation of each. I'll invite Jasminka first to present their initiative shortly, and then we'll go through the other panelists. Thank you very much. Jasminka, welcome, and the floor is yours.
Hello, everyone. Greetings from Belgrade. Hi, Alana. Thank you for gathering us. It's so great to see so many familiar faces that you haven't seen for a while, especially in those, you know, crazy circumstances. Speaking about emergency fund, I will focus on what we have done in Serbia and make connection later on a bit with the comparative report you referred to. So bearing in mind that we are primarily a research organization, it's not surprised that our project actually consists of the research that covers primary and secondary schools across Serbia, with the aim of providing reliable data on the school staff experience in responding to COVID-19 situation and how it influenced changes in organization of the schoolwork, organization and implementation of the distance, actually online teaching and learning, assessment to students and things like that. Why it has been so important. It is important since there is no such a study or research has been done so far. And we really need it as a country, kind of the evidence on school experience and on newly established practices. Speaking about sample or participating schools, probably you all know that we have a pretty huge number of the different schools and pretty developed school network that assumes primary schools, secondary schools that are divided into the few groups. So we have vocational schools, we have general education schools, as well as art schools. So for us, it was important to have all the type of schools involved in the research, since so many of them have some specificities. For example, for the vocational schools, it was important how work-based learning is organized, knowing that a huge number of students is implementing their professional practice in the companies. For the art schools that assume practice assumed, you know, gathering of so many people and things like that. So at the end, we send online questionnaire and 50 directors of primary schools and 100 teachers of primary schools, 30 directors and 60 teachers from vet schools, 15 directors of general schools and 15 teachers of general schools, as well as 5 directors and 10 teachers from art schools participated. The specific questions or areas that we have asked them were divided into the few, let's say, sections. So school directors are asked about their practices and experiences related to organization of school work and management of human resources, which was particularly important because usually we forget that actually teachers and their families are also exposed to the virus. So it means that it happens that in some schools happened actually that a lot of teachers were sick. So it was rather challenging, even you have in theory perfect management system, it was pretty much challenging to organize schoolwork. So we were interested to research how directors were informed on the steps they had taken at the beginning of the state of emergency and later on during the distance learning, how well they were informed on the final examination and how they organized, which was of specific importance for the primary schools, bearing in mind that final examination is used in our country for enrollment to secondary schools. But also it was interesting to see how they organized final examination in vocational schools, since such an examination needs to involve the different stakeholders, including employers, economy representatives, etc. We surveyed what they were main challenges for them, how they overcome obstacles, what were the main sources of their information, how helpful were different stakeholders in informing them. I suppose in many other countries it was pretty the same. The new information on how to organize, what to do, how to protect students, how to involve students from vulnerable groups, how to secure techniques and technologies changed from day to day, at least in Serbia. So for us, it was very much important to see actually how information flow went and who was helpful and where were the challenges in communication. Speaking about teachers, we focused our questions rather on their teaching and learning activities they implemented during the online teaching. We were interested to see what methods and tools they used, how did they create the teaching materials, how did they grade students, how did they collect students' feedbacks, and how they involved different groups of students, as well as how they communicated with students and how they communicated with parents, because communication with parents is something that suffered a lot during you know this situation. And at the end, upon the completion of the research, we organized three online events with the aim of presenting the research results to different audience, and it was good because some policymakers, representatives of national institutions, including Ministry of Education, participated in, and at the end we hope so actually that evidences we collected will have you know a kind of the reflection in some future policies regarding to education that it's we are still implementing in this state of emergency.
Thank you, Jasminka, for this introduction. Jane, can we hear from you and what Praxis has done?
Yes, of course. My greetings from Tallinn, Estonia, and I'm very pleased to be invited here in this conference. Happy to hear our ideas about our project as well, which is called Alarm Bell, yes. So I started up with a problem, why we started this this project, and it was initiated by the reason that, or the evidence that every sixth student in Estonia doesn't complete their studies within the nominal period in the secondary school. So this is quite a big amount of students, and then and there are, of course, there are several reasons behind that. For example, the problems or potential problems of students are not noticed, or they are noticed too late when the problem has already worsened. Sometimes there are not clearly defined roles and responsibilities, who should react to students' problems. For example, if there's a problem in a specific subject, in mathematics, for example, who should do something? Is it the mathematics teacher? Is it a class teacher, is it a support specialist? So there are like a bunch of people who should do something, but when and who exactly, this is kind of undecided sometimes. There's also a situation or a problem that there is not enough knowledge on how to react to a problem. Our teachers might not have adequate skills, social skills, like how to deal with delicate situations, how, for example, to approach a student in case of a problem, or talk with parents. And these are all very delicate situations, and then some teachers are not like prepared for these kinds of situations. And also which is like, it's very human aspect also, like not knowing when it is the right time to react or intervene. We kind of tend to think that maybe this problem kind of passes, maybe it's not that serious enough, and so on and so on. So all these factors contribute to this situation that the problems might not be noticed. And this is how we decided to develop this our intervention that we call Alarm Bell. which should be from one hand as an alert system or a warning system, early warning system, and from the other hand, a response system that would help to react to the students' problems. So what it is, it's based on online information system that schools use in Estonia. There are two information platforms. One is called Studium and the other one is called eCall or eSchool in English. And the second one is the one that we used for that. There are slightly more than 50% of the gymnasiums that use this platform. So it has a good coverage among gymnasiums. And all the student outcomes, study outcomes are inserted to this information system. So the idea of this new module in this system is to automatically identify the risks in case of each student and send out a warning if a certain pattern in a study outcomes or study behavior has emerged. And these risk factors, we have defined them ourselves. It's about average grades, it's about absences, it takes into account negative remarks, also being late to lessons is one factor. So it's nothing new, but basically in order to work, we had to define them more specifically. And insert them and develop them in this information tool. One of the central aspects of our intervention is a message that the teacher receives, and in some cases it's also a support specialist. So this message displays someone's mic is on, kind of. Tanya, maybe you can mute your. Thank you. Otherwise, it got a little bit noisy. So yeah, I was talking about like this central message or that the teacher receives when this risk factors are identified in case of a student. It uses a social norm or social comparison that indicates how the results or the behavior of the student deviates from other students. So, for example, it might say that in the last 2 weeks, Jana is one of the few in the class who has had unauthorized absences on 3 different days. And it also says that talking to a student will help you find out if Jana needs support to progress in their studies. So it kind of, yes, uses this behavioral insight and then the social comparison aspect and nudges teachers to react and not just them to speak to a student and verify whether he or she needs some help or some assistance in order to progress. So there might be warnings on 3 different levels depending on how severe is the problem or the reasons behind the warning. On 3rd level, the message goes automatically also to a support specialist. So this is our idea how to engage more than one person in the school when there is a potential problem, and that it wouldn't be only the responsibility of one person. And so this is the idea of the project. And what we are doing now is that we try to carry out the study starting from January, a randomized control trial in order to investigate whether this intervention really has an impact and what kind of impact. Because in some cases, with the science, you can also worsen the situation. There can adverse effects as well, especially if you use these social norms and social comparison. So therefore, I think it is very important to measure the real effect of this intervention. So thank you.
Thank you, Jane. Thank you. Jana or Jane, I'm not sure. Are you Jana or?
It is Jana, yes. But
thank you so much. It's an interesting something that we haven't seen actually before, because it tries to use the online resources that we have and the nudging method in order to actually alarm the system, the school, the teacher, the student, that there might be a problem. And we'll see when the measurement comes out how effective that is. Thank you. Batya, something completely different now, direct work with students. So Batya, tell us about your project.
Hello, everyone. Greetings from Mongolia. Good evening. Actually, it's evening already. And happy to see you all. So what we have done is during the pandemic, school closure in the past two school years, Mongolia is one of the few countries that had the longest days of school closure. And it is estimated that in the past two school years, about 50% of the school days were off, not in classroom. And the last year's estimation by Ministry of Education said that about 180,000 students, which is about a quarter of students in secondary school, which is from grade 1 through 12, were not able to access any kind of distance learning, either be it on TV, internet, or any other types of learning. So our idea was to end. The other part was that because of the pandemic and because of the, you know, especially this year, when the issue of learning loss that was caused by the pandemic, because of that, any other activities than teaching is not taking place in schools, which means extracurricular activities are off. So what we had thought of was to promote students to raise their voices and talk about issues that concerns them and try to promote active citizenship among students. So NEA, one of the three programmatic areas is youth development. And within our program, we try to support extracurricular activities that fosters children's right to expression and right to participation. And we started long time ago with the debate programs, debate clubs at schools. And then we have also supported the creation of film clubs that try to raise issues through watching documentaries and other video materials. And then the third program is a student journalism club, actually was initially supported by the education support program in early, almost 10 years ago. So what we have done, what we tried to do was first try to give students some knowledge about media and information literacy. Second, help students set up independent student journalism clubs at schools. And then through the newspapers and other media channels, students raise their voices about the issues that concerns them. And so the selection of the location was an issue because initially we planned to do everything in person, because in September last year the schools started reopening. And then when we were preparing to start, launch the program, we had the next lockdown and we had to readjust and make everything into online and do everything through Zoom and other platforms. And we approached the third largest city in the country because we wanted to reach, the initial idea was to reach as many schools as possible. And because the city has more than 20 schools and 16 of the schools were public schools. So that was it. And then we announced the program and had requirements for school selection that the school should provide support to the clubs, not only during the program during the project time, but after the project ends, and to have it included in the what is called the extracurricular plan of the school year, and other requirements. And to our surprise, all 16 public schools applied, and they agreed that they would help set up the clubs as well as support it in the long run. So what we started with the initial training, where the training was done through Zoom, and we used different learning platforms, applications like Padlet, Mentimeter, Jamboard, so to make the online training interactive. Then the schools set up their clubs. In the training, we involved one teacher who would be a guide for the film club and two students from each school. And then after the initial training, the students went back to their school and organized the training for the other students who enrolled in the club, and they started their activities. So the training was concentrating on, of course, first on media and information literacy, second about different media types, more focusing on newspaper, print and online forms, and how to write, what different types of writings. And the fourth part was about sustainability, how to promote their newspaper and how to continue running their clubs. So usually the clubs are divided into different teams. Like there are journalists, there are editors, there are marketing team. So it is also providing students some practice on entrepreneurship. So the clubs are running now, even the schools reopened, extracurricular activities are also not allowed. So still students are meeting online after the school hours and running their clubs. So basically this is it, and maybe I can talk more about the issues students raised later.
Thank you very much, Batya. So this one is about student voice. Very happy to hear about that, as one of the things that we definitely understand that are crucial for our systems. Okay, so these were the introductions to three very different, as you can see, quite different projects, programs, one working on really the research, one piloting something that could be an alarm bell and like a warning, and then one working directly with students on their voice. Jasminka, a question for you now. So what do you find the systems have done or can do in the future crisis from your study?
Well, I'm going to divide my answer, you know, what they have done and definitely what were the biggest challenges actually identified as areas they can do more. So for us, I have to be frank, pretty surprisingly, it seems like that all the countries established, and now I'm speaking about joint results, you know, not just for the Serbia, but as well as for Kazakhstan and Romania, because our partners done pretty similar research in those two countries. So it seems like that all the countries actually established more or less efficient information flow at different levels. So they had a great and done actually great information exchange and cooperation with national authorities and with local educational authorities in the countries where such a level of educational authorities exist. At the same time, it seems like that communication between school management and the teachers were pretty good. Unfortunately, less good with the parents and students, but a lot of things has been done in that area. So for the first time, you know, teachers and the principals organized some teams meeting with the parents, survivor groups and things like that. So it seems like that most of the participants in education haven't had serious problems with information flow and cooperation in that area. At the same time, all the countries and all the schools participated established very good virtual environments, not just for the communication, but as well as for the teaching and students' learning. It is different from country to country. For example, in countries they used Microsoft Teams, in some countries Padlet platform, also Zoom was widely used, Google Classrooms, Google Meet opportunities, and similar. And it seems like, and it was also, I don't know, at least for me, a pretty huge surprise, but teachers reported that they have pretty much developed ICT competencies. And teachers reported that they attended at least one in-service training dedicated to teachers' digital competencies development the last 2 years. So not just, you know, during the pandemic time, but, you know, before it, which is pretty good sign. But also they reported on a very well-developed, how to say, peer learning practice during the pandemic time. Interesting. And it was interesting because it was a huge challenge before the pandemic. Teachers in all the countries reported that they are using formative assessment much more than usually. Yes, exactly. It was very interesting because formative assessment appeared to be a challenge in general for the years in all the countries. However, what schools further made done and what was identified, the first thing is not related to the, but mostly mentioned, it's not related directly to education process, is how actually to monitor and implement health protection measures. For all the, you know, schools, it seems like it's a huge problem. The second one is directly related to teaching and learning process because all of the teachers and the school directors in all the type of schools said that planning and organizing, not implementing itself, of the distance learning is a huge challenge and that this is the area we need to work together in order to improve it. And the third is a more complex one, and it seems like that it's you know, just a technical issue, because we call it widely, you know, lack of equipment. So many other challenges is connected with it. Lack of equipment at the first place means that so many students actually haven't had access to the learning, to the distance learning. So schools needed to find some other more traditional ways. Even according to some other research data, it seems like that TV lessons are, you know, not enough, that the printing materials and delivering to students is not also enough. So schools and actually system can do in the future something regarding to establishing some system of inclusion of those students, and mostly from vulnerable groups who do not have access to the equipment as well as to the internet connection. And just a small footnote regarding to Jana and Batya said, you know, we still don't have, even we have some mechanisms for the early warning and intervention systems when dropout, you know, it's happening. We still don't know, even our assessment is that this crisis and the lack of equipment and internet connection will have influence not just on the knowledge loss, but as well as on dropout. We are expecting that it's going to be huge. And it's great to see that there were some initiatives regarding the establishing of the learning clubs. Since in Serbia at this very moment some voices are very loud in advocacy of establishing of the learning clubs as the one of the solutions for the situation, not maybe for the extracurricular activities, but rather as a kind of the homework clubs or remedial teaching clubs. So I hope so for the next conference we will know how such clubs are working in our environment.
Thank you, Asminka. Jana, Batya, any examples from your countries of what has been done in the crisis or how system has prepared? Just a quick reflection of what Jasmin has shared with us, if you have. Jana, go ahead.
Yes, well, in Estonia, I think we can't talk that much about technical issues, that we don't have internet access, well, we don't have computers, also electronic platforms. Actually, the access is pretty good. I think the technical, like the preparedness for this distance learning is actually very good. So I just wanted to point out maybe one, I wouldn't say positive effect of the crisis, but the possibility for the crisis. We have talked in Estonia for years about the importance of e-schooling and electronic platforms, how to use different IT tools in order to improve the study process. And actually, it's still now, or this has been now the moment when the teachers and the students actually have had to use these tools. And we see that even though we have talked about these tools for years, there is a quite big lack in the skills and the motivation to use them. So I just hope that it kind of improves these skills now, that it is a kind of motivates teachers to improve themselves in IT and then to use different platforms and tools. I think it still has potential as well. It's not only like entirely negative. All this experience on distance learning. So from our like point of view or the point of view from our project, I think in these very messy times, I hope that this alarm bell helps to or supports teachers again in the identification of potential problems in early phases. So that's
thank
my answer.
You, thank you. Of course, we're not surprised that Estonia had all the equipment as an e-country of our region, definitely, and not only in the region. But yeah, interesting that this has actually motivated or they were forced to start being motivated to use all the availability that they do have. Batya from Mongolia.
So as I mentioned earlier, about a quarter of students were not able to have access to different types of online learning opportunities. So this the crisis has made it even more clear that the marginalized and at risk groups, the situation of them even got even worse. So for instance, the children of the nomadic herder families, children with disabilities or special educational needs, children from poorer families, especially from the outskirt areas of the capital city. So there were the schools identified children living in families even without electricity at all, not to talk about gadgets, devices, or even TV. So based on that, the one of the things that the current ministry is trying to do is they are trying to look at the picture, the bigger picture, and during the last summer, they set up a quite big working group, consists of different agencies, including Institute of Education, Institute for Teacher Professional Development, plus NGOs, to develop a comprehensive plan, a three-year program to address the learning loss and support student learning. And they've managed to bring in all the development partners on board. And now it is, the plan is approved and it is in the process of starting and addressing these issues. And one of the issues is that the blended learning is going to be a focus, and also trying to look at more at student-centered learning, individualization and differentiation in learning. So.
Okay, thank you, Batya. We move back to Jana now, and to see, you talked about what you're trying to do with the nudging system and trying to have the alarm bell. You are concentrating, I would say that, you know, so we said that the pandemic made the position of vulnerable groups, of course, even more vulnerable, and your initiative is focused on dropout of low SES students. Do you know any examples where this has been used before for dropouts in different systems that you can share with us?
Well, nudging is becoming like increasingly popular in all policy fields, and the educational sector is not exemption in this regard. So yes, there are, like, nudging has been used in many ways. For example, defaults and framing and goal setting reminders, like this is all can be nudging. Like I said, we used social comparison and social norm. Yes, it has been used with very different results. For example, I remember like one study that investigated like how giving feedback about the best performance in the class results the overall average in the class. So this actually produced the negative effect that the average became lower because the best performance saw that the social norm is different and they didn't like their performance decreased. So it can produce like very, very different effects. And in this sense, we have to be very careful how to apply this nudge and social norm in our study. I think what is slightly different in our case is that we are not addressing the message to the student, which is usually done. We kind of had it in our heads and we thought about it, but for now we decided to send it only to the teacher because we thought that, okay, these are people in a very maybe a fragile age, teenagers, some might have problems, some have a very difficult socioeconomic background. So getting a message about like how he or she is deviates from the class average, or that he or she is worse than others in the class doesn't motivate, I would think. So yeah, the information is directed to the teacher, who decides like whether it is a real problem. Maybe sometimes it can be a technical problem, or maybe the teacher hasn't inserted relevant information to the system, so it's kind of a miss warning. And in this sense, in this case, the teacher can close the warning and the alarm. But when coming back to the nudges, then I think the closest intervention, which is not entirely nudge based, but the intervention as such has been used in US, that is collect, check and connect, that also tried to identify the students in a dropout risk and then to kind of nudge teachers to get in connection with them and then talk to them like about their potential problems. But the difference here with our project is that we use this big data and digitalized information systems and data. But in original form, this check and connect was done manually. So this is the main difference.
Okay, thank you. I think it's a very interesting initiative because on one hand, one would think that the teacher should notice these things without the nudging system. But let's hope that that this will help. And I guess warning others in school is an interesting idea. So let's see how it works. I'm really glad you're not telling the students that they're doing worse than the average in their classroom. let's see how it works. But we're really excited to see the results of the pilot study when they're out. So it will be interesting. But yeah, tell us about the topics and what did the students really raise through their journalist clubs? I think that's interesting for us to hear.
Okay, so during the initial training, we started the conversation with the students because there were only two students from a school about what are the current issues that students have. And then they were asked to continue this discussion when they go back to school, to their schools and go back to their schools and discuss with their club members. And they came up with different issues. So I have a list of issues here. So first one is quite a big issue, the COVID situation and the children's right to education, a large topic. Students' voice and views and the ways of listening to the students' voices and how to ensure student participation. The healthy lifestyle, especially doing more exercise and movements, especially during the school closures. Another issue was how to prevent from peer pressure, peer bullying, because it is one of the issues that is coming up quite often and more so on media. Online environment and child development. And the other topic was about environmental protection, green future, and how, what can students do to around that. And also the kind of questionnaires and other means to identify what students want to have on the newspaper. So these were the issues that students had. And I think we've shared the Google Drive where we have some examples of school newspapers. And now some the clubs are either having print newspapers or online versions of newspapers. So we can get more updates on what other issues they are talking about these days.
Thank you, Batya. This is actually a good time that I also mentioned that in the following days, we will have little videos of all our emergency funds coming out on our social media, and we'll be sharing them with you during the conference as well. We have one from students in Mongolia who talk about how this works and what issues they've raised. I find it very interesting that actually the issues they raised, like the right to education and how COVID has affected that, is crucial for their lives. I can understand that they would be concerned with. And all of the topics that they've raised are actually very actual and very, very important. And for me, the question is then for both Jasminka and Jana, what happens with student voice in your countries? Do we have any good examples of something that is being done, Jasminka?
Well, nothing systemic and nothing related to the big scale research, as it should be, I suppose, because now we are in pandemic time, you know, for around 2 years. However, Ministry of Education, Institute for Psychology and UNICEF actually done one research that it's related to monitoring of participation and learning of students from vulnerable groups, which is of particular interest for all of us, as well as the Network of Organization for Children of Serbia, actually done a very good one that covers children satisfaction with the online learning, parents' abilities to support students at home if online learning is not of the quality they find adequate, and dedicated to identification of the specific challenges regarding to the distance learning. Also, UNICEF done something they're calling U-Report that covers not just the students in primary and secondary education, but as well as students in higher education institutions on how students organize their self, and again what are the biggest challenging for them in online learning. So you know, speaking about specific challenges and what they found, actually that students are in general not satisfied with the online learning. And not just in the way how it's organized, but as well as what teachers are request from the students and what they're providing, what the teachers are providing in those times. Even I haven't mentioned before, but now I'm mentioning, even teachers are actually underlining that they are under the huge stress. And it's, you know, for them, this is one, you know, stress and frustration, which came with this new situation, is something that prevents them to take care much more about students' learning and the students' needs. And again, something interesting is that students confess actually that they are not, you know, self-organized enough, that they learn from this situation that they need to improve their, you know, self-regulation and self-learning and self-organizational skills.
Thank you, Jasmin. Very interesting points there. I wonder if they learn how to self-organize with somehow our support or at least a willingness to listen to them. But yes, some positive, let's say, moves.
You know, for us, you know, we discussed, you know, internally about such results, and for us, it means in general that teachers, even without, you know, pandemic or before pandemic, are still much more trapped in the traditional styles of teaching. So that self-regulation of learning is not something that teachers usually are, you know, developing with the students and insist on it. So it's still rather, teachers are still not, you know, facilitators of the process, but still they perceive themselves as someone who is, you know, interpreting and, you know, sending information to students. So definitely this is evergreen problem, not just the one related to pandemic, but now appears as a very much important.
Thank you very much. Again, another proof that pandemic has just been like a litmus paper for actual situation in schools and in the system in general. Jana, what about student voice in Estonia? Any good stories there?
Well, I think in Estonia, the students' voices and different institutions and channels to hear these voices are pretty well established, I would say. There is, for example, a Union of Estonian Student Council, also the Estonian National Youth Council, which are pretty strong NGOs and which are like engaged in the policymaking process on a regular basis, actually. So through these organizations, which actually have their connection with individual schools and individual students, they kind of can channel their worries during the times of crisis now, during the pandemics, but in more general questions as well. Like other aspects, for example, young people can vote in municipal elections when they're 16. So I think this is also one way to express their opinions and worries and kind of influence the decisions and politics that is made. And also, yes, there are some very recent studies as well, like how the pandemic has influenced the situation of young people, especially in terms of mental well-being and occupation. And of course, I'm not the best person to talk about this study, but it brought out like some negative effects, of course, that young people had or experienced more severely compared with other age groups, for example. But in general terms, I would say that young people can express their opinions quite well.
Thank you very much, Jana. Yes, our study that we did in Estonia also showed that there is more space and more support for student voices in Estonia than we have in our region. We do have these unions and school boards and student boards in schools in almost all countries. However, how implemented they are and whether we listen to them and who gets into the boards, I think is also a big issue for our countries. So the support to student voice is interesting that it came out at the end of this session as well as at the end of the last session. Thank you for the speakers, but I would like to open for any comments or questions that the audience might have before we close this session. We are right on time, but I'm sure everybody could spare another 5 to 10 minutes if there is questions or comments that anybody would like to share. You could write it in a comment or just start speaking. Everything is fine. I think Ulvi is trying to say something. Do you want? No? You can turn on your mic if you want.
I just would like to share my some general comment that the presentations we hear, the experience we heard today, it's really a perfect match with what NEPC is doing and with the goal of conferences to understand the contributions of countries in this crisis situations and the opportunities existing. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Olivia. Yes, we are very proud of our membership. Fast reaction to the emergency that arised and everything that was done in different countries through the emergency funds, but also without the emergency funds. A lot has been going on. And yes, we tried to showcase it today. So as there doesn't seem to be other questions and comments, I will close this panel for now. Thank you again to Yasmin, Kayana, and Batya for their experiences in sharing their projects, to everybody who participated and listened. We will continue the conference with a session at 12:30 Central European time, so in an hour, with the panel on inclusion, and we're waiting for you there. Thank you again, and see you in an hour for those who are joining us. Goodbye.